How are you?
Good, good. Doing well.
Wonderful, wonderful. Well, I should say welcome to CWS as it is. And thanks for joining us. Dr. Ramsaroop, please give us a brief description of this man we have come to know as Peter Ramsaroop, Dr. Peter Ramsaroop.
Well, that's a little self coming forward to discuss myself, but you know, I'm a gentleman that loves to Guyana, I'm passionate about changes that are necessary for our country, involvement of all citizens in our development, and working together. I think that's the key of us going forward in this decade, is that we've got to realize that it's not one or the other. It's all of us putting our hands up and making a difference for our nation. And that's me. And I like to keep my agenda focused, and as much as I can contribute to the development of our nation, that's what I want to do.
Mm-hmm. Peter, you were presidential candidate for the 2011 elections, member of APNU, Chief Executive Officer of Alliance for Change. What have you learned from your intimate relationship with these parties?
Well, I mean, my goal, as some folks or pundits have said, is to be part of every political party in order to understand, you know, why we can't come together to make a difference. You know, I, for the most part, have been on the opposition ranks over the years, looking at other ways to change our nation. I mean, APNU have some great people inside. I've no doubt about that. A lot of the folks are my friends. Same thing with the AFC. You know, so there are good people all around Guyana, and even in our current government. All of us, I think, have sometimes the same passion, is how we go about implementing and making a difference is where you normally see the disconnect. And, you know, our type of politics in Guyana is very vindictive. We've got to have much more of a softer, gentler approach in this campaign and any future campaign, in order, we cannot continue the way we have done it in the past. And, you know, I don't think we have started well already in the campaign, both from APNU, AFC, and even the PPP. We've got to figure out, you know, I think the voters, I think one of the prerequisite of this conversation with you is, what do the voters want? And I think the voters want, and someone used that term today in social media, that we are exhausted. The voters are exhausted in having to go through another campaign. What I think most of us want, and I believe your previous guest mentioned the term autopilot. I think most of us want to see Guyana in a friendlier approach into our politics, and the development to continue. And I think that the process of how our development is being categorized, what throws, you know, people off, that says, well, Guyana is in bad shape.
Well, Peter, let me ask you something, though. You mentioned that the voters are tired or exhausted of the campaign. But isn't that a normal process, though, for political change, for elections?
Yes. Mm-hmm. But you know, we're in an early election. The last 3 years have been, in my mind, a nightmare in terms of how the 10th Parliament has operated. You know, we should not hold Guyana hostage. My disagreement with the 10th Parliament and the APNU-led coalition with the AFC in Parliament is that you do not stop projects. I mean, you may question the process, you may question the approach, but you cannot put Guyana on a standstill. There are many things that should have happened over the last 3 years. From the airport expansion to a lot of the other things that were stopped in Parliament, you've got to look and say, well, is it going to hurt Guyana in the future? It will. I think the last 3 years have put Guyana 10 years backwards. Mm-hmm.
So, Peter, if you were elected president of Guyana today, what are five policies you will change right away?
Well, I mean, we are a nation under development, no doubt about that. We're strategically located. We've got great opportunities ahead of us. Policies that needs to happen. Definitely, we all have talked in the past at all levels that we have to have much more of a transparent system. Even the perception of favoritism or corruption, whether true or not, should not really be an agenda topic. It should be, well, you know, the best person got the work, you know, we're moving forward. So a much more transparency. But we've got to focus on the development. Guyana cannot be at a standstill or go backwards. We've got to continue massive development. We are should be what I call a transport-led economy. What we are sitting on is an infrastructure potential, infrastructure opportunity to be that integrator in the Caribbean and South America. A good example is, you know, the Deepwater Harbor that we have talked about for 30, 40 years needs to get off the ground. If the opposition 40 years needs to get off the ground, if the opposition's got to vote for that, if they are still the opposition or the government got to work with the opposition to get that happen, that needs to happen. Deepwater Harbor, the road to Brazil, the expansion of the airport, the interconnectivity and technology, the alternative energy projects that must be integrated, those would change Guyana into a transport-led economy. If we use our roadways, we use our waterways, we connect South America and the Caribbean, then the products that we can produce, the manufacturing production to the agriculture investment, those are all things that then would change the nation. Jobs will be will happen much more than it maybe have happened over the last few years. But on the other hand, if you have been to Guyana 5 years ago to Guyana today, it has changed drastically. There's a significant development infrastructure going up. People say, well, it's not just about buildings. It's not about buildings, but it's about what goes on in the building. I mean, I, for example, tried to hire a mason the other day. I can't find a mason. People say, well, you know, we should have had the masons working in the Marriott. There is no, the work, there's so much work to do in Guyana that people are not out there lining up for jobs. You know, a lot of Guyanese like to be entrepreneurs and they go out and do their own work. You know, we've got call centers popping up, a new building in Rob Street that is going to house 1,500 new workers. These are things that I think is improving our nation. So why then are people still unhappy? And that's what we've
maybe,
got.
Maybe Guyana needs to adopt a similar strategy or policy that America adopted in terms of job training. Perhaps the jobs that are coming around, the people are not trained for that. Let me ask something, Peter. Historically, in any society where you've had a change of government, the opposition, and we right here in America with the Republicans, it is very difficult for the president to get certain policies, policy changes. But there's always, in any change of government, the opposition will always oppose whatever
the
policy is. Let's say, Peter, that there's a change of government, and for the infrastructure that you're speaking so eloquently about, the Deep Harbor and all these different things, would you then, if you were in the opposition at the point, encourage your colleagues to support anything that the new government or some of the infrastructure changes that you're championing now, would you encourage them to support it?
Absolutely. I mean, as part of the opposition, I these are programs that we presented. So I was surprised that the opposition, the current opposition, disapproved or put a stop to some of these programs. I mean, we should not. If I was opposition tomorrow, those projects should definitely continue. So there are certain things that the ingredients of building our nation to the next level gotta cut across our political, I call it childishness that you see these politicians go through.
Peter, I'm curious about something. About something. I'm sure you have colleagues in all these different parties.
Yeah.
Because you've been such an integral part of each of them. Have you ever asked why these particular oppositions, and what are some of the explanations you've gotten?
Well, I mean, I think the term trading and compromise are things that we don't know how to do that in Guyana. I think when the Amalia Falls project was up and for debate, I think the AFC said to the president, you know, why not create a procurement commission and we'll vote for the Amalia Falls. Well, that didn't happen. So at the end of the day, there was no procurement commission and there was no Amalia Falls. That is said, the term compromise and trading in politics is normal. So we've got to get to that level for that to happen. So I think is our style of politics. I mean, I as a citizen, and if I take myself out of the political arena, you know, the George Bush Senior of the world says, you know, we need a softer, gentler approach to Guyana. And I think if we can get that, the voters, you know, the autopilot that your previous guest talked about may go away. The fact we ought to be much more involved in our development. You know, people tend to blame government for everything. And there's no need to be. You know, if the city is dirty, you know, people say, well, it's the government. Well, it's not the government. We are throwing trash on the road. We're throwing trash in the trench. We're throwing trash out of the minibus. And then we said the government is not cleaning the city. Georgetown is a dirty city. Well, yes, infrastructure has to be in place, but a cultural change among us, the people of Guyana, needs to happen. And government has to help facilitate
that. Hold that thought, Peter. Let me just go into the chat room. Harold asked, who is holding up the road to Brazil and the Deepwater Harbor? I'm not aware of any discussions in Parliament on this.
No, the 10th Parliament, I mean, got stuck with the Amalia Falls, got stuck with the airport expansion, and I think time ran out for, I mean, these are projects that when I campaigned, even with the current government in 2011, was on top of the list for the manifesto to make happen. So by the time the third year came around, you know, and all of the debacles in the 10th Parliament, these projects never got above, you know, on the table to get started. Now, there's a lot of work done on the road to Brazil. I think it's a matter of getting it paved now will be the next step. I mean, but I like to see alternatives, I mean, such as a railroad. I mean, we absolutely don't need the road tomorrow to Brazil, but, you know, an idea that should float along, let's build a railroad. Let's get the carriages on the train, bringing the goods from Brazil into our harbor. Now, we've got to get to the deepwater harbor for the biggest ships to come. There's an argument between where the harbor should go. Should it go into Essequibo? Should it go into Burbies? So the fact is, I think both the opposition and the government knows that the harbor needs to happen. And I think a feasibility study is currently on the way to figure, you know, how to get that done. But again, as a development country, you know, money is not just there to do any of these things. You've got to create the package. You've got to get the external resources to facilitate the loans and all of that to make these things happen. But we've got to get started. I mean, so what would be nice post 2015 election, regardless of the power play, is that the top five items on all of our manifestos, if you look at the PP manifesto on those five items, they should be no different than the AFC or the APNU manifesto. So if they're all five there, then what we're arguing about is approach and transparency and how it works. So that's what we've got to tackle.
Peter, when did you return to Guyana? What surprised you most about that?
The system is powerful. I mean, I returned in 2003, so it's over 10 years now, and, you know, try to do business. There is not a, you know, the system, the way we have, we have not invested in infrastructural changes enough, institutional changes. You know, the public servants, the public service, the whole integrated approach that holds up the economy. Those are things, you know, constitutional change that needs to happen. Those are things that we keep ignoring every election. But we've got to get to that level. I mean, and I tell, you know, the president these same things. So I'm not hiding anything that I would not have said publicly, that we all need to work together to make some of the necessary changes. I think the current government, as a whole, got the right plan. I mean, nothing in the PPP plan is bad.
Let me ask you this, Peter, and I want to tap into your analytical skills here. How would you compare this government's record to the previous under Barrett Jackdaw? And what is different?
Well, it's difficult to compare the two.
Where would you attribute the most growth?
The minority, as a minority government, you tend not to be able to do anything really. So, you know, it can compare. I think, you know, in retrospect, looking at the Jagdeo government, we had a stable economy. Now, there were a lot of issues in terms of certain approaches that people disagree, and including myself. I mean, I was an advocate of certain things that should not have happened during his tenure. But the fact that numbers and the economy has been on the rise, or GDP has been on the rise, you know, there's a stable approach to our macro economy, or micro economy is doing fairly decent. I mean, you don't see a long line of people begging for money and waiting for jobs. You know, everybody, and you've got drive up the East Coast, and everybody's happy, laughing, smiling, you know, talking with their family. They have food on the table. So we have to look and say, you know, are we such a bad shape, or is it, are we accepting where we're at, and do we really want more? I mean, politicians want more, but a lot of times, I mean, people are doing fairly well.
Peter, as you travel the country and you see people sitting on their steps and laughing and enjoying life, the wonderment of life in Guyana, what is it that you see, or what is it that the likes of Nigel Hughes and Mark Benchcroft that travel the same country, stop certain villages, yet they're hearing cries for lack of of health care, hunger, and these different things?
Well, I travel the country too. We tend to like the rum shop discussions.
Uh-huh.
You know, if I go tomorrow and talk to five PPP supporters, they'll have all kinds of negative things to say, even about their own government. Same thing with APNU or AFC. We are a very critical society. That we are, you know, it's everything seems bad to us. It's just the nature. But on the other hand, you know, we are very, you know, loving society. We are integrated. We're happy. There's really no racial tensions on the ground, you know, prior to any elections. So yes, there are some areas that are, I would say, depressed that needs to be focused on. I think the hinterland needs more infrastructure development, more roads. You know, we've got to tend to move industries to those areas. But to move industries to those areas, the private sector and the public sector has to come together. The partnership, the P3 partnership, needs to happen. But government tends have to facilitate that. But there have to be a connect between the private sector and the public sector. So we've got to move industries out to those regions in order for them to develop. I mean, I've always pushed for smaller hydroelectric power, say, in Bartica. They used to have that years ago. Now, if we develop Bartica as a hub for mining production, then bigger centers can go up right in that area. I mean, you know, I think we need a change of our tax system. You know, central government should not be alone managing the taxes of our country. It needs to be local. So all that gold coming out of Bartica, a large percentage of that money should go right back to developing Bartica.
Let me just jump in the chat room for a second. Camille Wilcock, with all these important projects pending, the parliament should be in session, not prorogued. That's a statement. Harold said, ex-president Lula wanted to build a hydro falls at Brazil's expense and give Guyana more electricity than we would get from Amelia. Why didn't we push for that and use the Amelia money for some other infrastructure, so as to speed up the building of infrastructure?
Yeah, I mean, definitely Brazil is a partner, should be a major partner of Guyana. You know, I don't know what transpired. You know, many politicians say, you know, we'll build a fall, we'll do this, you know, the president,
former president. There's another part of the statement. He said we could have even used that money for the railroad.
Well, yeah, but that's the point. I mean, it's nothing wrong with that comment at all. The fact is, there, you know, in the, there, you know, in the meantime, my argument on both sides is, you know, I believe, you know, we need alternative energy, but Amalia Falls, even if it was developed, is 5-10 years out. Where are we in the solar plant? You know, where are we in wind power? How do we integrate, you know, how do we put alternative energy? You know, I've always been, you know, let's push from sugar to ethanol, and let's create energy through sugar cane. There are multiple, which happens, I think, to some extent with the sugar factory out of quarantine. So there have been small steps towards that. But, you know, the fact is that's a good discussion. In Parliament, when the opposition disapproved the funding for Amalia Falls or the approach, right away, Mr. Greenidge, if he was smart enough, should have, General Greenidge should have been, not Greenidge, General Granger, should have put a plan on the table, says, okay, let's propose alternative energy. Let's do two falls in Bartica or one in Tiger Hills and out of Linden area, and let's get some energy going in these regions. And if we do that, we'll support the capital investment of Amalia Falls. But instead, you have a negative. Nope, we're not doing it, end of story. The same thing with airport expansion. And in my mind, I travel a lot. I feel we need an airport expansion. We need better service so that you know, you people can come in. You don't just say no. What are the alternatives? When you disapproved the 2013 budget, I told Mr. Greenidge, why didn't you throw down your budget on the parliament? I know we don't have that system, but what different would you do than the current government?
Well, Peter, Mr. Greenidge,
better, and you do not hear that in the discussions in Parliament. All we have debates is that we wouldn't do it.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, Mr. Greenidge is not here to answer for himself. Perhaps I can bring the two of you back to have a proper conversation and discussion on this matter. But I want to ask you something. It's difficult to think about politics in Guyana or change of government and not look at it from a historical perspective. And so with this, I ask you this question, right? If you had the opportunity to speak with late President LFS Burnham, Dr. Chetty Jagan, Dr. Walter Rodney, and recent President Barrett Jackdeal, you had to ask them, let's take one question each. What would you ask?
Well, I mean, I would ask, you know, why didn't your vision for Guyana...
Who is this you're asking now?
Each of them, directly. Why didn't all their vision for Guyana come about? We know President Burnham had a great vision for a nation. Even some of the things today are happening, such as, you know, the Grow More Food campaign and all those things we need to be able to sustain ourselves. You know, I mean, Dr. Jagan was big on the infrastructure of Guyana, getting the working class out there. Same thing with Dr. Rodney. They all had some great ideas and great plans of how to improve our nation. They even tried, you know, coming together and breaking up and working together like some of us have done. You know, it seems like we follow the same traditions that these guys have done in the past. So the question is, to them, is why? What will we be able to do now in the 21st century, in this decade, different than you have done? How could we achieve the vision for a better country where all of us are getting there? And I think the current government of Don Ramatar or the PPP administration has the plan. They want to do it, but it's got to be supported. I mean, the same thing with Chetty Jagan and President Burnham is that they worked together in the past, then they broke up, and then that was it. You know, the country went and divide itself, continue to divide itself. We've got to get a softer, gentler approach. We've got to be able to work together. We've got to be able to fight politics. We've got to be able to disagree. But at the end of the day, we should not hold our nation hostage. We all have to make a difference going
Peter,
forward.
Should the PPP change its style of politics if they win? Do you believe they can? And what would you want to see them change?
I think they have to work more in integrating all of society a little much better. I think the perception of certain things, whether it's the perception of corruption, the perception of discrimination, you know, if I was sitting at a high office, I wouldn't want that accusation. Is that we've got to do the things that make everybody feel that they are part of our country. And that's something that I think, you know, the current government, I mean, and this election campaign is the time for them to do it. They've got to work towards an approach that says, you know, we are pushing for all of Guyana. We want one Guyana. And that's the platform I think Don Ramatar is pushing. We want one platform. We want a better Guyana. But again, we've got to do more than words. We've got to have a softer approach where we are able to shake the hands of each other and says we're going to do it together. And, you know, yes, politics is not about everybody working together. It's got to be an opposition. It's got to be a third force in there. It's got to be critics. It has to be pundits saying good and bad. We all know that. But again, I go back to my core. We should not hold Guyana hostage. None of us, from Nigel Hughes to Dr. Granger or General Granger to Moses Nagamutu, we all got to say, okay.
What about President Ramatar?
President Ramatar, absolutely.
Isn't he included in that too?
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes, he needs to be. I mean, and the burden is on him. I mean, as the president, you hold that end stick. You've got the most power to make these things happen. And I believe, you know, he needs to take that challenge much more seriously in this election and ensure that he comes across that way, that he plans to integrate our nation as a whole and do a good job at it. I mean, Donald's my friend. I mean, President is my friend.
I think
he can do the right job, but there's got to be an integrated approach to making Guyana better.
Talking about integrated approach, have you ever thought of, I mean, you know, Mark Benchcoff has gone the route of an independent candidate. Have you ever considered that perhaps with all this knowledge and experience you have and vision, being a member of parliament might give you much more leverage in implementing some of these changes you so ardently argue for?
Well, I mean, I've had opportunities to be in parliament many times. I've not, you know, President Hoyt offered me a seat in 2001 to take a seat in parliament. I did not. I mean, because our system is not set up to have the right debates. We have to have constitutional changes. I mean, I believe we need to be representing a constituency. You know, we can't always be party politics in parliament. So until the constitution gets debated and changed at the right level, you know, the Marks and the Peter Ramsroops of the world cannot influence the change necessary within our system. We've got to have the political pundits that are there right now. I mean, and John Granger campaign in 2011, that the fact that the number one thing they want to do is change the Constitution. You know, you need 67% to change it. That didn't happen. There was no discussion in the 10th Parliament of constitutional changes. So we're back to the same old Constitution, and I think President Burnham was one of the most brilliant men in our nation. I mean, he wrote a perfect Constitution, and everybody that has used it so far have benefited from it.
Perfect is relative, I presume, Peter.
Yeah.
Peter, if the coalition wins the election and you are called upon by President Granger or Prime Minister Nagamutu or whatever for your for advice, would you?
Absolutely. I mean the folks all around. I mean, I have no personal reason not to work with Jerome Granger, Nigel Hughes to Moses Nagamutu. Those are colleagues, in my mind, that all have passion for a country. Same thing with the current government. There's no need not to say I wouldn't serve our nation in my expertise. You know, you may disagree with political approaches, you may disagree with certain political policies, but if you're asked to serve your country, you ought to serve it.
Thank you. Peter, any closing thoughts?
No, I think it's going to be a very interesting election. I think the numbers are pretty much in the hands of the current government. I think it's an upward battle for the opposition to hold on to a certain level of votes that they will need to. But at the end of the day, I hope the debate and the discussions of what are the plans necessary to move our nation forward is discussed, is debated, and it's agreed to. So regardless of who comes out as the winner, we get those five things done that needs to happen to move Guyana to the next level.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you so very much, Dr. Ramsaroop. It has been a pleasure.
Appreciate it.
Hopefully we'll have another conversation sometime in the future.
Great, absolutely.
All right.
My colleague, Nigel, I hope best of luck.
Have a good evening. He's scheduled to be on next, so maybe you can join. You can go to the website and look at the conversation between us.
Great.
But
thank you.
Thanks. Keep up the good work.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.